It is so good to see all of you back tonight. Quite a few of you came returning, and I'm grateful for that. And it was such a joy this morning to see that crowd. What an incredible thing. And tonight, what a joy to see each of your faces. I enjoy that. God is so good. Hey, with your hymns, you just grab that bulletin. You're going to look at the side that says evening, of course, and just stay in your car if you can. Continue to pray for the missionaries. Pray for the missions force. Pray that God will continue to bless them. I was talking to my father this afternoon. Some of them are really hurt right now because of not being able to get into churches. Pray for Dr. Bruce Miller right here. He's had a hard time getting into churches because of all of this. And he needs to get into the churches. He needs to be able to. And so continue to be in prayer for missionaries, for evangelists, for our college. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for the night. I praise you for Brother Gary. I thank you, Lord, for his enthusiasm and his love for you. I pray, Lord, that you will bless him as he comes and gives so much, dear Lord God, for your honor and glory during these hymns and the way that he directs. I pray, Father, that you'll give us and that our hearts, dear Lord, would be stirred with this idea. Oh, God, help, for we don't have any help outside of you. Help, for you alone are all that we can look to. Help, oh, precious King. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's look at that song. It's a day by day.
So, Easter is over. Now what? We sang, we worshiped, we celebrated. Jesus is alive. His promises are fulfilled. The story is complete. Right? Actually, it's not. Easter wasn't the conclusion. Easter was just the beginning. Now, it's our turn to go into the world, preaching, baptizing, discipling every nation, and we don't have to do it alone because we know Jesus is alive, and he will be right there with us until the very end.
Yes.
Hey, man, let's grab that song list again. He Will Hold Me Fast.
That you are our help, you are our stay, you are our anchor, you are our all in all. We never have to worry because you are there. You're behind, you're in front, you're everywhere. You're the Alpha, you're the Omega, you're the beginning, you're the end. You'll always be present, and we praise you for that. Now, Lord, as we come into our time of giving you our offerings, we're sometimes embarrassed. Because we haven't thought ahead. Sometimes we want to give more, and we may not have what we'd like to give. But Lord, as we give our tenth, as we give above our tenth, as we give to missions, as we give the meager pennies that might be in our wallet, Lord, we give you all that we can. For certainly, Father, we want to leave with nothing left. We want you, dear Lord God, to have it all by the time this world is coming to an end and we are headed to your arms. Make it so, I pray, In Jesus' name, amen.
Could it be that we're so heavenly minded that somehow we've been blinded to what He's calling us to do right here? Could it be that heaven's always planted, that we leave here empty-handed when this life disappears? But is it really living if my one ambition is simply hanging on till we all get out of here? One heartbeat in this chest, I want to see His kingdom come. I won't wish my life away, I want to live each day to give away what I've been given. I don't want to leave here with regret, I want to leave with nothing left. And what I've learned through living, I know exactly what I need to do. So I pray that God will give me chances to show how great His grace is by living out His truth. If somehow I could choose it, I'd be the one God uses to make a difference in what forever means to you. I don't want to waste a breath, one heartbeat in this chest. I want to see His kingdom come in. I won't wish my life away, I want to live each day to give away what I've been given.
Up if that's still necessary, but go on, brother, sing Be Thou My Vision. Let's continue.
Say that Thou art.
I know this last song, and it's not in here, but it does go very well with the message. I'm going to have Thomas kind of turn the sound up just a little bit so you can hear the words well. We've done it a few times at church, quite a few actually. Surrender all. Listen to this as we get ready to go into the sermon in Joshua 4 and then throughout the Word of God. Several things I want you to see that go with that very precious message.
Take all.
I want so much more to make you focus.
Remember when you got saved?
Hey.
You remember that? Anybody here remember when they got saved? Tell me if that wasn't an amazing time.
It was.
Now, what do you remember? That's the question. What do you remember about the day you got saved? Let me tell you a couple things, because you can't tell me where you're at. I'll tell you a couple things about the day I got saved. I remember a nickel. You know there was a nickel. This guy, Mr. Nash, took a nickel and he put it in my pocket. And he said, "Can you feel that nickel in your pocket?" I said, "Well, yeah, I can feel the nickel." He said, "Now listen, when you get saved, you're going to know Jesus Christ is in you just as real as you feel that nickel in your pocket." Now, I was 9 years old and this was 1978. So I was excited about that nickel, okay? That was a big deal to me. And so that nickel, Mr. Nash, the stairwell we were in, I'm going to tell you, there are some things about salvation I remember. What do you remember about that day? I mean, the day you genuinely got saved. What do you remember about the Spirit of God entering your being and changing you forever? Do you remember that, Brother Ryan? Do you remember that day? The Holy Spirit of God getting a hold of you, Brother Brad, and changing you forever? Do you remember that? How the Lord in one particular moment came and got a hold of you and changed you forever? Oh, my friends, I'm going to tell you, I remember that day. I remember the day that my sister Julie in New Hampshire, when my father was preaching at the Sunshine Baptist Church, when she walked down the aisle at 23 years old and she said, "Dad, I want to get saved." And my father's jaw dropped to the floor because my sister has a mental challenge and it's been difficult for her to understand very simple concepts. But my friend, that day, Julie, this very deeply mentally challenged young girl, came to the Lord Jesus Christ in full knowledge of what he wanted of her and said to him, "Oh Lord, God, be my Lord, be my Savior, and take me unto yourself." I'm going to tell you, that was a special day for Julia. Now turn with me, if you will, before you go to Joshua 4, which is our main text tonight. Go to Revelation 2 and verse 17, will you? Grab the Bible and go to Revelation chapter 2 and verse 17 and read this awesome text. It says this, "To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone. And in the stone a new name written, which is no man knoweth, saving him that receiveth it." Oh, my friends, I'm going to tell you something. No one can know what you experienced in the day of your salvation except for you. And it was different for every single one of us. Because just like a snowflake, every single one of us is different. And the Lord makes that experience unique to you. He makes that beautiful moment that your name was written down in heaven, He makes it unique to you. And the beautiful white stone that He gives to you of salvation will be unique to you, even though the exact same Christ and the only way, the only truth, the only life is our salvation. He somehow makes His relationship to you special and different and unique. And I can't understand that. But Miss Faye, your relationship to God will never be mine. Yours is completely unique. Your name is different. Your whole outlook in life is different. And you know what He has written on your heart. And I can't know it, but you can. My friends, this morning, three things were examined. We looked at three things to examine. I told you that we'd give the second half of that message tonight. But those three things were this. First, self-examination. Second, the chosen things in you that need to be examined. And third, your past in itself needing to be examined. And how God works and cleanses and moves through examination. Now tonight, we're going to talk from the same text. And this is three things to remember as you look to the future through examining the past. Three things to remember as you look to the future as you examine the past. Let's start, my friends, where we ended this morning in verses 3 and 8. You're in Joshua chapter 4 and verses 3 and 8. And it says, "And command ye them, saying, take you hence out of the midst of Jordan, out of the place where the priest's feet stood firm, 12 stones." Does that sound familiar? Revelation chapter 2 and verse 17 says that we are a white stone. We have a white stone. And that stone has our name on it. And this says that they're to take a stone. They were to choose a stone. Something unique to them. Something special to them. And it says, "Ye shall carry them over with you and leave them in the lodging place where ye shall lodge this night." And we talked about how important that is, because we need to meditate. We need to sleep on that stone. We need to think through that stone. Now read verse 8 with me out loud, if you will. "And the children of Israel did so, as Joshua commanded, and took up 12 stones out of the midst of Jordan, as the Lord spake unto Joshua, according to the number of the tribes of the children of Israel, and carried them over with them unto the place where they lodged, and laid them down there." They laid them down there. The first thing tonight, think through this and wonder for a moment. Praise God for this. Listen, the first thing to remember is where you got the stone. All right? Remember where you got the stone. Remember the stairwell in which you were saved. Remember the place that God mercifully saved your soul. Remember the instance. Remember the moment. The person that you were with at the time. "Take you hence," the Word of God says, "out of the midst of Jordan," my friends. Right as you're crossing Jordan, remember the experience when you first got saved. In your experience, to where? The midst, the Word of God says. Now look with me at verse 9, if you will. What does it say? "And Joshua set up 12 stones in the midst of Jordan, in the place where the feet of the priests which bear the ark of the covenant stood. And they are there," when? "Unto this day." Can I tell you, my friend, once you've set up the stone, once the Lord has given you that white, beautiful stone, it's forever. It is forever. And I'm here to tell you, Hebrews 13 and verse 5 says you can be content with such things as ye have. For he said, "I will never leave you, forsake you." 1 John chapter 5 and verse 13 tells us that these things were written unto you that believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that ye may know that you have eternal life. My friends, John chapter 10 clarifies that his sheep hears his voice and that they will never perish, that they will always be his. Remember where you got the stone. Go back to hence, verses 3 and 8. Go back to hence. Take you hence out of the midst of Jordan in your experience. To where? To the midst, my friends. To the midst in your experience of crossing over in verses 9 and then into verse 10. Read with me, will you? Look at verses 9 and then reading into verse 10. Read verse 10 out loud right there in your car. You ready? For the priests which bear the ark stood in the midst of Jordan until everything was finished that the Lord commanded Joshua to speak unto the people, according to all that Moses commanded Joshua, and the people hasted and passed over. Can I tell you something about your salvation? It is finished, my friends. It is finished. The Lord has finished the work. He's done the work. He's done it all. John 19 and verses 28 through 30 explain that Jesus Christ on that cross said very clearly, now that it's all done, oh Lord God, it's finished and I'm coming to you. I'm going to be at your right hand. Oh Lord, I'm there. I'm with you. I am apart with you now. When my wife makes a cake, how many of you honk at me if you enjoy a cake once in a while? When my wife makes a cake or some pizza or something to that effect, I can't eat it. No, I'm just kidding. That's not really what I was going to say. But I can't eat some of it because it's gluten, full of gluten, and it gives me headaches. And there are times last, I don't know when it was, I think it was Friday night. Was it Friday? I had some of that Kung Pao. You know what that is, right? It's the chicken, or is that right? Or General, what's his name's chicken, or whatever it is. This chicken has breading on it. And I got to tell you, Marion, it looks so good, I just had to pop it in my mouth. And I did. And it wasn't long after I had a headache, just like I knew I would. But my wife, when she's making a cake, every once in a while, I'll go in there. She'll make some gluten-free stuff once in a while. In fact, today, she made some gluten-free stuff for me to eat. Now, I'll go in there once in a while when the batter's about halfway done. And I'll stick my finger in there, and I'll eat that, and I'll say, oh, what is that? You know why? Because it's not finished. You see, when you try to get in with God and you haven't allowed Him to finish the work, you're not saved. And it's going to taste bad. But I'm going to tell you this. The moment that you give your heart to Jesus Christ and you allow Him to finish the work, my friends, He will. The Word of God tells us that what He did on the cross was sufficient. That the blood was sufficient. In my sanctification process every day, I see that little thing with the kid on it, your little picture, you know, that little poster with the kid on it that says, hey, be patient with me. God's not finished yet. You know what I'm saying? I've got to tell you this, in your salvation experience, it's finished if you receive Christ and the blood has covered your sin and you've repented, you're finished. You're done. You aren't half baked. You're finished. But when it comes to salvation and sanctification, there's a difference between the two. And right now, in the middle of my life, I'm about half-baked when it comes to sanctification. I'm not completely holy. And sometimes people will see me and they'll say, oh, you just messed up. And that happens all the time. Tell me if you don't get somebody looking at you once in a while, oh, you just messed up. Now, they don't understand. You're a half-baked cake. And you're going to be bitter in their eyes. And I'm going to tell you that our Lord, our Savior, our God wants to finish the work in you. But my friends, right now, while you're in the midst of things, while you're in the midst of life, God is still working with you. How many would say, oh, Pastor, I can't wait until He's done. I can't wait till I'm there. I can't wait until I'm with Him. My friend, do you feel that way? Do you desire for God to finish the work? Listen, be patient because He's not finished yet. Now look at number 2, if you will. Remember where you got the stone, as you saw there in verses 9 and 10. But number 2, remember where God always is. Write that down. Remember where God always is. You remember where you got that stone. But you remember where God always is. Look with me, you will, at verse 11. You understand what I mean. The Bible says it came to pass when all the people were clean passed over, that the ark of the Lord, we talked about what that means this morning, how that you are clean passed over. What does that mean? That you are completely given to Christ. You have completely given your heart to Jesus. You have confessed your sin. You have repented. The blood has covered you. And this is what this is speaking of. Clean passed over. It says that the ark of the Lord passed over, and the priests in the presence, listen now, in the presence of the people. Look at verse 12. And the children of Reuben and the children of Gad and the half tribe of Manasseh passed over, armed before the children of Israel, as Moses spake unto them, about 40,000 prepared for war. So what do you see here? All right, God was behind them. Did you see that? But God was in the midst of them. Did you see that? And God went before them. Did you see that? And God was everywhere around them. Did you see that? In verse 14, continue reading with me. Read it right out loud in your car. On that day the Lord magnified Joshua in the sight of all Israel, and they feared him as they feared Moses all the days of his life. And the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, command the priests that bear the ark of the testimony that they come up out of Jordan. Do you know where my God is? My God is coming out of Jordan. My God is above me. He's below me. He's around me. He's with me. He's always there. And in verse 17, Joshua therefore commanded the priests, saying, come ye up out of Jordan. And it came to pass, when the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord were come up out of the midst of Jordan, and the soles of the priests' feet were lifted up unto the dry land, that the waters of Jordan returned unto their place and flowed over all his banks as it did before. Our God is a protector. And when he's with us, there ain't no water, there ain't no flood, there ain't no fire, there ain't nothing that can keep us from him. My friends, our God and King will take care of us. Write this verse down, will you? Isaiah 52 and verse 12. Write it down. Isaiah 52 and verse 12 says this. For the Lord will go before you, and the God of Israel will be your reward. Now, how is that possible? Our God is omnipresent. Don't you get it? He's going before us. He's going behind us. He's above us. He's to our side. He's in our hands. He's in our lives. He's holding us. He's below us. God is everywhere. And Revelation 1 and verse 8 then explains, he's the Alpha, he's the Omega, he's the beginning, and he's the end. And our God is with us at all times. Oh, my friends, as I continue to preach to you about my lunch today, I need you to know something. I miss gluten. I miss bread. I miss bread with all my heart. I miss a big old slab of Texas toast. You know what I'm talking about, Mama? Them big old slabs of Texas toast. Might have some wheat in there. Might be white. Might be rye. But I miss it all there, Miss Hale. I miss it all. And by God's grace, one of these days when I get to heaven, there'll be something a whole lot more scrumptious than bread, I'm sure. But right now, I miss myself a good old sandwich. You know what I mean? One of them sandwiches where you got one slab of bread on one side, maybe some peanut butter and jelly on the other, and then another slab of bread. And then you got ham, you got cheese. Man, I don't know. I put pizza in there, potato chips, and all kinds of stuff in my sandwiches. And I'm sure you do too. But I love me a good sandwich. No bread allowed in Barry Seacrest's life these days. But God is a God sandwich, and he's above me, and he's below me, and he's all around me, and he considers me to be the good stuff in the middle. He loves me that much. And in Psalm 8, he tells us, you are the crown of my creation, son. I love you. I want to be around you. I want to be with you. And you are precious in my sight. Oh, my friends, I got to tell you something. Our Lord and King loves us and wants to be with us. He not only gave us that stone, and he wants us to remember where we got it, but he's with us now, Brother Ryan. He's with us always, Brother Ryan. He's with us always, Brother Pierce. My dear brothers and sisters, there's never a time that your God is going to leave you or forsake you. Don't ever, ever forget that. And then number three tonight, remember in all you do, in all you say, in all you think, in everything you hope to accomplish, to fear God. Fear Him. Don't just forget. Please don't forget about that stone where you got it. Don't ever forget that God's with you every day of your life. But my friends, the fact that He's there ought to make you tremble. The fact that He's there ought to make you tremble. It ought to be in your heart. It ought to be in your spirit. It ought to be in your soul. Your life ought to want to change because of that. We're coming up out of Jordan, just as my sister, special sister, such a sweet girl. She has some mental challenges. The day that she received the Lord Jesus Christ, she said, I want to be baptized. But see, my sister Julie is mentally ill, mentally challenged. And my sister is scared to death of water. Do you understand? My sister is scared of water. And so my sister came up out of that water when she was baptized without a single fear of that water. You understand? Not a single fear of that water. Do you fear the hand of the living God? Do you fear the almighty hand of God? Do you favor Him? Do you desire Him? Do you love Him? Do you look to Him? My friends, Julie feared God more than that water. And she had made her choice that she was going to be with Christ. She was going to do what needed to be done. Now her salvation was finished. You know, our baptism has nothing to do with our salvation. Baptism is just a picture of what happens in your heart. But because of her fear of God, she wanted to take that first step of obedience. And what she did when she took that first step of obedience was she came unto Him and she said, Lord, I will fear You more than water. And that is what you see here with the Israelites. In verse 19, they entered into Jordan. They weren't scared of what could happen because they knew their God was above them and below them and beside them and behind them and in front of them. And in verse 19, as you read, the people came up out of Jordan on the 10th day of the first month and encamped in Gilgal in the east border of Jericho, just as you and I will come up out of the water after our first steps of obedience unto the Lord and glorify Him, for we have been faithful to Him. And the Lord sees that and says, oh, my son. Oh, my daughter, how precious it was to see you just baptized, to take that first step of obedience. And verse 20 says, those 12 stones which they took out of the Jordan did Joshua pitch in Gilgal. Look at this. And he spake unto the children of Israel, saying, when your children shall ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean these stones? Then ye shall let your children know, saying, Israel came over this Jordan on dry land. Now understand what this is saying. It is not saying that Joshua took the stones and pitched them off to the side. That's not what that's saying. The word pitch here is speaking of the same kind of thing that you would do with a tent. You would set up a tent. And that's what he did with these stones. He pitched them. In other words, he set up the stones so that they were a memorial, so that they would be seen, so they were not hidden, so they were open. My friends, you set up your salvation. Now, just a moment ago, I saw a couple police officers go by. You know what I wanted to do? I wanted to preach double loud. You know why? I want them to know that we are pitching a monument to Christ right here at First Baptist Church. And those police officers were kind enough just to go on as they're looking at the sign. But oh, my friends, would you, having known that they were there, would you have hightailed it out of here, scared that they might take your license plate? I certainly would hope not. I would hope that you'd stand and be firm and pitch a monument. Pitch a monument. Pitch a monument. Let them know that Jesus Christ is your Savior and Lord, and you're not ashamed of the Lord Jesus Christ. You're not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. As Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. And you and I ought never to be ashamed. We ought to set up that man monument and let God have His way. Why? I fear God. God, not the police officers. I fear God, not the government. I fear God, not these neighbors here. I fear God alone. And He alone is the reason that I live. He's my reason for living and giving and doing and being. And verse 23 then goes on, for the Lord your God dried up the waters of Jordan from before you until you were passed over as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea, which you dried up from before us until we were gone over. That all the people of the earth, listen now, my friends, that all the people of the earth might know the hand of the Lord, that it is mighty, that ye might fear the Lord your God forever, forever, forever. May we fear the Lord our God. May we fear Him above all men. May we fear Him above all things. May He alone be our Lord, our God, and our King. When I first married Barbara, it was terrifying. I didn't know what I was doing. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Now, she seemed to know perfectly what she was doing. But my friends, I've got news for you. As well as my mom and dad trained me, they could never have prepared me for being a husband in a family. They could never have prepared me for being a leader in a family. And I was scared to death. And as time passed, I started to see mistakes. Not in myself, but in Barbara. No, I'm just kidding. I started to see mistakes in myself over and over again. Now, those of you who are married here, you know what I'm talking about. We are constantly making mistakes. Am I wrong? We are constantly making mistakes. We are constantly doing wrong before God. We're constantly saying things. Boy, I tell you, my heart just jumped in my throat. We're constantly saying things that we might regret, right? Hey, I'm a Peter just like anybody, but it scares me to death when I see them suckers going by like that. I'll tell you, my friends, 1 Peter chapter 3, isn't that curious? We're just talking about Peter. 1 Peter chapter 3 became my theme verse, Daddy. It became my theme verse. You know what, Tom? Norma Jean, this ought to be your theme verse at the beginning of your marriage. Those of you who are young couples or are young in marriage, this ought to be your theme verse. 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 12. Now verse 7 says, you're to treat your wife as a fragile glass. And that treatment ought to be such because we fear our God. We fear the Lord. And so we treat our wives with great care. And we treat our children with great care. And what mistakes, what awful sin, what terrible things we commit when we don't. But 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 12 says this, the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and His ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord, listen now, the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. Now, my friends, this is not saying the face of the Lord is against the evil. It's saying it's against the face of those. It's against those. His face is against those who do evil. On any given day, I can be a pretty evil dude. How about you? On any given day, I can do pretty wrong. I'm talking on a practical level here. Now, in Christ, you're perfect in every way. And before Him, He looks at you and He loves you and He's grateful that you're His son. You'll never be anything but a son of God if you're now a son of God. If you were saved and sanctified, you are sanctified forever. But practically, on a daily basis, I can do some pretty bad stuff. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Now, it might be something that you do and you feel horrible about it, but my friends, at least for a little while, until you confess it, until it's under the Lord's confessive hand. Again, you are clean from top to bottom, from head to toe. But as you walk through this filthy world, your feet get dirty. And the Lord gives us an example of why He washed His disciples' feet. Because we do need to come to Him on a daily basis and confess that sin before Him. Oh, friends, it's not worth it to not have accounts that are clean with God. Do you understand what I'm saying? Do you understand why? Well, let's go through and review. Because number one, if we forget where we got that stone, we're in trouble. If number two, we forget why God is always around us and for us, we're in trouble. And if we forget to fear the Almighty on a living, daily, moment-to-by-moment basis, we're in trouble. Here's the reason. Listen. We shall behold Him. We shall behold Him face to face in all of His glory. Oh, we shall behold Him. Oh, we shall behold Him face to face. Our Savior and Lord. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes for just a moment and think about why it is that we remember what we remember. Think about why it is that those living stones represented here in Joshua chapter 4, that white stone with your name written on it, needs to be remembered. The sense of that salvation moment, the things that took place in the day of my salvation, what I remember about the Spirit of God entering into me and changing me forever ought never to be forgotten. That I must remember that our God is around us and above us and behind us and before us. And we must remember in all we do and say and think and accomplish that our King is to be feared in all things, because He alone is God. I cannot, I will not be anything but Barry Seacrest until the day that I die. And may God help me in glory as He brings me unto Himself, even now, to remember that glorified time is only because of His grace. My friends, remembering this forever, it's only by His grace that we're saved. Do this now, my friends. If you have not received Christ, He's waiting for you. The Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Just right now, why not invite Him to come in? Dear Lord, pray if you will right now with an open heart. Lord, take me. I know I'm not much, but I want that stone with a new name on it. And I want You to take me unto Yourself. I believe You died on the cross. I believe Your Father raised You from the dead 3 days later. And I repent. I repent. According to Luke 13, I must repent or I will perish. I ask You, Lord, to take me and change me. Transform me, for only You can. Transform me, for only You can do that. Help me in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen to this song. And if you know it, sing along with it. What a friend we have in Jesus. To bring to Him tonight, do it right now. Remember where you got that stone. Remember, he's with you all the way. Remember to fear him in all you do and say. Because we remember where the manna comes from. Because we remember where we saw that stone, dear Lord. Where we made it our own. Where you wrote our name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Where you, O Father, took us in and became our Alpha and Omega. Our beginning, our end. Where you, dear Lord God, enveloped us and taught us fear of you. We now, dear Lord God, confess to you our need. And we ask you to help us. Oh God, help us every day. Help us. We need to live for you, oh God. As we fear you, help us to do your work. In Jesus' name, amen. Next week at 9:30, we're going to start a half hour of Sunday school. And then at 10 o'clock, we're going to start another half hour of Sunday school. And then at 10:30, we're going to start another half hour of Sunday school. At 11 o'clock, we're going to have worship. Now, how's that going to work? Well, that's the only...